Well, hi everyone. My name's Steve Layson. I'm part of the ministry team here at Gerringong Anglican Church, and I'd like to welcome you to our online service this morning. Thank you for joining us. Later on in the service, we'll be sharing the Lord's Supper together, so if you haven't done so already, you might like to grab some bread or some wine so we share this meal later together. But to begin our service, will you join with me as we start by singing a great hymn of praise to God? Well, as I said earlier, we're going to be sharing the Lord's Supper together. But if you would take up your service books and turn to page 134, we'll be following the second order of communion today. The Lord be with you. Let's hear from the Word of God. Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honour and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. Let us pray the prayer of preparation together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbour as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy on us, and write your law in our hearts by your Holy Spirit." Now, of course, we don't always manage to do those things, do we? Loving God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, let alone our neighbour as ourselves. So in penitence and faith, let's confess our sins to Almighty God. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins. Strengthen you to do his will and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In response to that message of forgiveness, will you join with me as we encourage each other and we praise God for that great forgiveness he's won for us. Let's say together, "Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Lord, mercifully receive the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that we may perceive and know what things we ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to perform them, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's hear from God's word now.
Today our reading is from the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew, chapter 9, beginning at verse 35. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." He called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles: first, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew; James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John; Philip and Bartholomew; Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector; James, son of Alphaeus; and Thaddeus; Simon the Zealot; and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, preach this message: the kingdom of heaven is near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Do not take along any gold or silver or copper in your belts. Take no bag for the journey, or extra tunic, or sandals, or a staff, for the worker is worth his keep. Whatever town or village you enter, search for some worthy person there and stay at his house until you leave. As you enter the home, give it your greeting. If the home is deserving, let your peace rest on it. If it is not, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake the dust off your feet when you leave that home or town. I tell you the truth, it will be more bearable for Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. I am sending you out like sheep among wolves. Therefore, be as shrewd as snakes and as innocent as doves, but be on your guard against men. They will hand you over to the local councils and flog you in their synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say, for it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Good morning. I'm reading from St. Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 4, verses 2 to 6. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Be wise in the way you act toward outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, in a moment, we're going to spend some time thinking about the implications of those passages for our lives. But before we do, let's encourage each other with the words of the Nicene Creed, the things that bind us as Christians. On page 139, we say together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Well, I'm going to tell you something that you never really expected a minister to say from the front of church in a sermon. It might shock you. If you're a Christian, you should pray. I know, shocking, right? Of course, that is exactly what you expect someone like myself to say. It's one of those motherhood and apple pie statements, isn't it? We all know that we should pray, even if it doesn't always mean that we do so. Today we're starting off a series preparing for our mission in September, our Spring to Life mission. And as we prepare to reach out with the gospel, we're going to spend a couple of weeks just looking at some of the things that we can do to prepare ourselves. And we're going to start off by thinking about prayer, the place of prayer. And it may not surprise you that I'm going to say that you should pray about mission. It's one of those things that, again, you expect me to say. But that's all very well, but is there anything that we can say more than that? What I'm going to try and do today is quite simple, really. I'm just going to try and answer three simple questions. Why should we pray? What should we pray for? And how should we pray? So why should we pray? What should we pray for? And how should we pray? So So first of all, why should we pray? We all know that prayer is meant to be important, but why is it so important? Well, especially when it comes to evangelism and mission. Well, there are probably more reasons, but I came up with three reasons why it's so important. The first one is one that we've seen in recent weeks. It's because as we try to share our faith in the world, we are actually taking part in a spiritual battle. That was something we saw incredibly vividly in the book of Revelation, but it was also there in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, where Paul says, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. He puts it slightly differently in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4, where he says, the God of this age has blinded the hearts of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel. You see, when we aim to share our faith with someone, we can know for sure that the devil has already been at work trying to make sure that they don't listen. So as we go out to share our faith, the devil is working against us. But as Wiki reminded us last week, God is the power behind mission. We may do the watering and the seed planting, or the seed planting, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 3, but it is God who makes faith grow. That's why one of the key spiritual weapons that Paul describes in Ephesians 6 is to pray in the Spirit on all occasions, with all kinds of prayers and requests, to keep on praying for all the saints and also for him. I mean, you wouldn't turn up to a gunfight carrying a pistol, nor should you turn up to a spiritual battle with mere human skills. If we are to make any headway in this spiritual battle, we need to make use of our key spiritual weapons, of which prayer is one of the most important. So prayer is important because we're taking part in a spiritual battle. But the second reason we need to pray is because of the sheer size of the task. In the passage we had read from Matthew chapter 9, Jesus looks out and he sees the crowds. He sees how plentiful they are, and not only are their numbers plentiful, but their problems are plentiful. They are harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And aren't those two things still true today? So many people are living their lives with no hope, with no ultimate meaning, no ultimate joy or peace, chasing after things that won't satisfy them and don't last, even if they do. I wonder if you know people like that, people who you think, if only you knew Jesus, if you only knew how much he loves you and the hope that he can give to you, these dramas that fill your life would be put into perspective. So the depth of people's problems is huge, but also the size of the task is still huge. As I said earlier, we're about to start our Spring to Life mission. And as a church, we've got about 120 people in our church, and we hope to make a big impact on our town. But our town, Gerringong, has some 4,000 people. That means even if every single one of us, all 120 of us, was able to share our faith with one person, to invite them to come along, and incredibly, they became Christian. Wouldn't that be amazing? Even if we did see that happen, then that would mean we'd only had 240 people, which is still only 6% of our whole town, meaning there will be 94% that still don't know Jesus. Our task is huge, let alone when you take into account the towns around us, or Sydney, or the rest of Australia, or China, or India, or Afghanistan, or Brazil, or Nigeria, and so many countries in the world. We are so small, and the task is so big. We have so little power. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 1 that we are the foolish, the weak, the lowly, and despised things in our world. But we have a God who is wise and powerful and glorious, who loves to use people like us to do the impossible. And we need him if we're going to achieve anything in this task. So we need to pray because we are taking part in a spiritual battle and it's a spiritual weapon. We need to pray because we are too small to do the task on our own. But also we are to pray because he tells us to. In response to the enormity of the task in Matthew 9, Jesus says to his disciples, therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest. Turn to God. Paul says to the Ephesian church, pray on all occasions and pray also for me. To Colossians, he says, devote yourselves to prayer. He says the same thing to the Thessalonians and to Timothy and over again in the New Testament. Prayer is no optional extra for the Christian when it comes to mission.
It is a command that we must obey. We must come before God and bring our request to him. We need it. We need him. And also we're told to do it. So yes, we need to pray. But what kind of things should we be praying for? Well, of course, there's no end to the things we can pray for, can and should pray for. But there are sort of just three that might be relevant for us in this context. The first one is to pray for the overall task. When Jesus sees the enormity of the task, he says to his disciples, he doesn't say to them, go and organise a mission fortnight or to donate lots of money. He says, ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. In other words, it's a big job. We need lots of workers to be out in the field doing it. The task is huge and it can't be done by only a few. More and more people need to hear the call to go into the mission field. It's not just the job of Jesus. It's not just the job of the disciples or of pastors or parish councils or wardens. This is the job that all of us need to do. It's interesting, of course, when Jesus says to his disciples to pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out missioners, that the very next thing that happens in chapter 10 is that they are sent out into the fields. So they pray for it, and then they are the answer to their own prayer. So it's a bit of a dangerous prayer for us to be asking, that God would send out workers in to do the task. And also, as we think about the task as a whole, it's good and appropriate for us to pray for the success of that task. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, Paul says, pray for us that the message of the Lord may spread rapidly and be honoured. In other words, he says, please pray that when Paul talks to people and those with him, when they talk to people about Jesus, that people's lives would be changed, that they would be saved. You see, when we start looking for and praying for opportunities for evangelism, we should also be looking for and praying for people to be saved. That is God's heart's desire. God longs that people would be saved. And so it's appropriate for us to ask that our labours should bear fruit. Now, of course, we need to remember that God is always sovereign over our evangelistic efforts, and there may be times in his sovereignty when we don't see immediate fruit. Sometimes, as Paul says, we might just be planting seeds or watering what someone else has planted. But there will also be times of harvest, and that is something that we should be praying for. So we should be praying for the success of the task at large. But also we need to be praying for those who are involved in the task. We need to be praying for those who take the message and those who hear it. We need to pray for the messengers. In a passage we had read from Colossians chapter 4, Paul invites the Colossians to pray for him. In particular, he wants to ask them to pray that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ. You see, Paul's job was to go around telling people about Jesus. But he recognises that nothing is going to happen unless God works in people's hearts to open doors so that they will be interested to hear. But it's not just Paul that is looking for opportunities. He says to Colossians that they should be wise in the way they act towards outsiders and they should make the most of every opportunity that they receive. In other words, we should be looking for and praying for opportunities to share our faith. And it's surprising when we're doing that when we're looking for and praying for these opportunities, how often those opportunities will come up. A bit like when you're thinking of buying a new car, you start seeing them everywhere. So for the messengers, we need to pray for opportunities. But of course, we don't just want dozens of opportunities to come along so that we can politely wave to them as they pass by. In Ephesians 6, when Paul asks them to pray for him, he specifically asks that they would pray that words may be given to him so that he would fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which he is an ambassador in chains. He says, pray that I may declare it fearlessly, as I should. I don't know about you, but I kind of imagine Paul to be some kind of evangelistic superhero who just automatically converts people and has no trouble sharing the gospel with them. But Paul wasn't naturally bold. He was supernaturally bold. He knew he needed God's help, and so he asked others to pray for him. Now, I figure if Paul knew that he needed prayer for boldness, then I think probably you and I do too. This is something we can really do for each other. See, Paul asked the Ephesians to pray for them. It happens throughout the book of Acts that the believers would get together to pray for each other for boldness. Now, we often get scared, don't we, when we're talking to others about Jesus? That's normal. But we're not alone. We are in this together. And so it's important for us to pray for each other, that we might be bold, that we would have opportunities, but that we would also take them. We are part of the body of Christ. We don't have to feel like we're alone in this. We can actually work together and pray for each other in this. So we need to pray for the messages of the gospel, but also for those who will hear it. See, if it's true, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4, that the minds of non-believers have been blinded, well, we need someone to open them. And who better to open the eyes of those who are blind than the one who continually opened the eyes of the blind, both physically and spiritually? Jesus did this throughout his ministry, and we need him to do it again and again and again for us. You see, the movement towards faith is a journey that most people take from complete antagonism or apathy through kind of vague interest before they turn to faith. And we need to pray for people every step along the way, wherever they are. We need to pray for those who are angry, that their anger may melt away. We should pray for those who are apathetic, that they might come to see how important it is to investigate who Jesus is. We should pray for those who have questions, that their questions might be answered. We should pray for those who are searching for hope and meaning, that they might find it in Jesus. We need to pray for people wherever they are on this journey. So we've seen that we've seen why we should pray, because we're part of a spiritual battle, because we need God because of the enormity of the task, and also because Jesus tells us to. But secondly, we've seen some of the things that we should be praying for. We should be praying for the task as a whole. We should pray for the messengers and the hearers of the gospel. But how do we do that? Well, again, I can think of there's two ways I think that we can pray. And the first one is to do it alone. Jesus says to his disciples, when you pray, go into a room and lock the door, because your Heavenly Father hears what you pray in secret. It's important for us to come to Jesus on our own. Jesus constantly did this in his ministry. It's one of the marks of his ministry, actually, that he would often leave the disciples to themselves and he would go off to pray. And it's something that it's important for us to do, to set aside specific times to pray. Maybe a particular time of the day, in the morning or at night before you go to bed, or maybe at lunchtime or in a break during the working day. Or perhaps you can just pray on the spur at the moment. When you're about to talk to someone, you know you're about to sit down and have lunch with that colleague who's expressed interest before, to sit down and to just send a prayer off to God, to ask him to be with you, to give you the opportunity and boldness. Maybe you could take advantage of those sheets that we've given out in previous weeks for those three people you can pray for, that you can just pray for them when you're on the bus or when you're travelling to or from work. Maybe you could pray for the events that we have coming up in our Spring to Life mission. Perhaps you could be praying for the mission as a whole or for our missionaries for all outreach. These are the kind of things that need to be part of our walk with God. We can do it alone. But also, sometimes prayer on our own can be difficult. We get distracted and our minds wander from one thing to the other. So one of the things that helps me to pray is to spend time with others. God has made us part of the body of Christ, and we should help each other in our prayers. Maybe there's someone close to you, either close to you physically or close to you, they may live miles away, but that you have close contact with. That you could just send them a text message when you're about to have lunch with a non-Christian friend, or to share the three people that you've been praying for, so that they could be praying for them too. One of the wonderful things we have in our church here is Bible study groups. And again, this is a place where we can share our worries, our concerns, our fears. We can pray for the people who are on our heart. We can pray for specific opportunities that are coming up. We can pray for different activities like the Spring to Life mission that's coming up. But it's not just Bible studies, of course. We pray in church, and one of the things we're doing today and in coming days is to pray for our mission. It's a constant theme. We're also going to be setting aside times in our church where we can come and pray together. So I want to encourage you to come and join us on Saturday the 3rd of September as we will be spending the time focusing on our upcoming mission.
please come and join us on that day. Or if 8 o'clock in the morning is too early for you, then come and join us on Wednesday the 7th, when we'll be meeting together at 7:30. As we come together, we'll sing to God and we'll give him praise, but also be praying for our mission. We can pray alone, but we can also pray together. These are the kind of things that will help us to put into practice the thing that we know we should be doing. It seems an obvious thing for me to say that we as Christians should be praying, particularly when it comes to mission. But it's important for us to hear and for us to remember and to act on, because we can so easily, particularly as we think about an upcoming fortnight of mission, we can so easily get caught up in activism, in doing things, getting all our plans and our programs and advertising, all those kind of things happening, that we actually neglect to spend time talking to the Lord of the harvest. Sometimes when we pray, it's just a rushed, last-minute thing. Oh, God, oh, by the way, we've done all the organising, but now could you do something? Prayer is not just an optional extra or an added tack-on thing at the end. It's not just an spiritual insurance policy. It's so much more than that. It's a vital part of the mission. And it's actually a part of the mission that we can all take part in. Not all of us are great evangelists. Not even all of us are great at inviting our friends or family. But all of us have the opportunity to pray. I told you at the beginning that I was going to tell you to pray, which is no big surprise. But I hope that you can now see why it's so important. We're part of a spiritual battle. The task that we're taking part in is a huge one. And also, Jesus has told us that we should pray. But we've also seen some of the things we can pray for. We can be praying for the mission at large, this upcoming mission, but the year-long mission to share our faith with others. We should be praying for ourselves and those who take the gospel message out, but also for those who are about to hear it. We can do it alone. We can do it together. We've thought about why we should pray, what we should pray, and how we should pray. The only thing left is for us to do it. So will you join with me as I pray? Dear Lord God, we thank you for the privilege it is to be part of your mission to save the world. You have sent each one of us out into this world to bring the good news to those we know and love, to those we come across. Lord God, we pray for this mission. We pray that you would be at work. We pray for those who are speaking, for those who are sharing their faith, for those who are inviting others to come. Give us opportunities. Give us boldness, we pray. And Lord, we pray for the success of that mission, that you would be at work in the hearts and minds of those who will hear, those who will be invited. We ask, Lord God, that your spirit would open the eyes of those who have been blinded by the devil. Lord, we pray that you would be at work, and we long to see the exciting things that you'll be doing. Lord, we commit ourselves and this mission, our year-long mission, to you in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Well, in response to what we've heard from God's word and in confidence and faith, let us pray for all people and for the church throughout the world. Almighty God, your Son Jesus Christ has promised that you'll hear us when we ask in faith. Receive the prayers we offer. We pray for the church across the world. We remember our link missionaries, the Cows in Italy, the Glovers in Phnom Penh, the Damons in Mudgee, and also the ministry of Shell Harbour Aboriginal Community Church. We pray also for our persecuted brothers and sisters across the world. Strengthen your people for their witness and work in the world, and empower your ministers faithfully to proclaim the gospel and to administer your holy sacraments. Unite in the truth all who confess your name, that we may live together in love and proclaim your glory in all the world. Father, hear our prayer. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We pray for the peoples of the world, particularly remembering those who are suffering, those who are suffering as a result of coronavirus, those who are suffering as a result of poverty, injustice, persecution. We pray for those who make laws in our own land and those across the world. Give wisdom to those in authority in every land. And guide all peoples in the way of righteousness and peace, so that they may share with justice the resources of the earth, work together in trust, and seek the common good. Father, hear our prayer
through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We pray for our own community, the members, people who live in Gerringong and surrounds, and all those in the communities in which we live, for those who are watching this service. We ask, Lord, that you might help us as we take the gospel to those who don't know you. We commend to your keeping, Father, ourselves and each other, our families, our neighbours and our friends. Enable us by your Spirit to live in love for you and for one another. Father, hear our prayer through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We pray for those who are in need. We remember those who are suffering, the poor, the depressed, the sick, the lonely, the outcast, those who are persecuted, and those who mourn. You may like to bring before God now those known to you who are suffering in any way. Comfort and heal, merciful Lord, all who are in sorrow, need, sickness, or any other trouble, particularly those that we have brought to mind today. Give them a firm trust in your goodness. Help those who minister to them, and bring us all into the joy of your salvation. Father, hear our prayer through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And we praise you, Lord God, for your faithful servants in every age. And we pray that we, with all who have died in the faith of Christ, may be brought to a joyful resurrection and the fulfilment of your eternal kingdom. Accept our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I'd like to invite you to join with me as we share in the Lord's Supper together. If you haven't already organised some bread and wine for yourself, you might like to go and do that right now. If you've already done that, then you might like to grab your green prayer books and turn to page 143. In John 3:16 we read, God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And St. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 11, as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup of the Lord, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Let a man examine himself, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Will you join with me at the prayer at the bottom of page 143? We do not presume to come to your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. We are the body of Christ. His Spirit is with us. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Will you turn with me in your Bibles, in your prayer book, to page 165. Page 165. As you do that, lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. All glory and honour, thanks and praise be yours now and always. Lord, Holy Father, mighty Creator, ever-living God, we give thanks and praise for your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who, by his death on the cross and rising to new life, offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, with the whole company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And now, Father, we pray that we who receive these, your gifts of bread and wine, according to our Saviour's word, may be partakers of his body and his blood. For on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And we give him thanks to you, his almighty Father, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We offer our prayer and praise, Father, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Blessing and honour and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen. We who are many are one body in Christ, for we all share in the one bread. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. So taking your bread, take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died that your sins could be forgiven, and be thankful. Taking your wine or juice, the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance of Christ's blood shed for you, and be thankful. Let us pray. In Revelation 3, verse 20, we read, "The Lord says, Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me." Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us in this hope that we have grasped, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. In the middle of page 174, we say together, Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. As we come towards the end of our service, will you join with me as we sing our final hymn? Well, Ken, I thank you for joining us for our online service today, and to invite you to come and join us again at the same time next week. But to finish off our service, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son and Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. Thanks for joining us. See you next time.